Well, since the theme is Jesus Loves Me, I think we're going to sing Jesus Loves Me. And then we'll have our lesson, or we'll have a prayer, and then we'll have a prayer.
Jesus loves me, this I know.
Heavenly Father, thank you for this day that you bless us to come together to get Camp Coddle and to sing praises to your name and to hear a lesson. Please help us this week, dear Father, to serve you and to be a shining light to those around us. And just keep us safe throughout the rest of this day and throughout the rest of this service. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I'm glad you're here, and I appreciate you. Look, don't run off because of what I'm going to say tonight. I'm going to be pretty hard on you tonight, all right? And I was told I could be, so I'm going to be, all right? I haven't seen, and I don't want to be disrespectful to any of you, but I want you to think about your life, because there's not very many people that have a pure direction and have a real life with Jesus. And I hope you do. I don't know. I hope you have a real strong stomach, okay? And I'm going to say something to you. And I want you to, this is going to be kind of crazy, I'm going to say. But there was a girl that had a bowl of chili. And she was sitting there, and she was sitting at her table, and all of a sudden the boy comes up, and he sits by her and says, "Look, can I have that?" And she shoved it over to him, and he ate it. When he got to the bottom of it, he looked, and there was a mouse at the bottom of that chili, and he puked his guts up. Well, the bad thing is she said, "I've done the same thing." Now, I say that to you for a reason. Now, I want you to pay attention a little bit. I want you to go to Revelation chapter 3. And I'm going to read something to you. We're going to start with verse 15 and 16. Revelation chapter 3, 15 and 16. Jesus says, "I know thy works, that thou art neither cold nor hot. I would thee were cold or hot. So then, because thou art lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will spew thee out of my mouth." That's sad. But you think about your life. How are your life? Are you a part-time Christian, or are you someone that all the time you've got the Lord on your mind? I want to give you some ideas here tonight to kind of help you out in the direction. All right? I'm going to read these to you in a minute. But if I asked you how important your life is with Christ, some of you would for surely raise your hand and say yes. But there's some things that I want you to balance a little bit in your life. One is, do you study your Bible daily? That's a big question. If you're going to have a pure life with Christ, you're going to study. And you're going to be able to pay attention when someone like this boy that went up there and got this chili, he probably would ask more questions instead of just sitting there eating it up. And that's what we do in life. We just eat whatever the world gives us, and we don't think about what the outcome will be until it's too late. And then because of that, bam, we're puking our guts up. But the bad thing is how does Jesus look at us? Would Jesus puke his guts up how we live our lives? And that's scary. So I want you, I'm here tonight, to ask you, and I'm begging you, to get on this pure direction and have a real life with Christ, all right? So think about it as we go. Now, some of these things are basic, but most people don't do them. So let's start with Acts 17, 11, please. thank you for that paper moving. I appreciate you, all right? That's very good. So here we go. These were more noble than those of Thessalonica, in that they received the word with all readiness of mind, and searched the scriptures daily whether those things were so. How about you? Do you search the scriptures daily to see if the things around you are really true and so, and the way God wants you to live your life and the people around you? Because if you don't, how do you know you're living that pure direction? Now, why it's so important, I want you to understand something. There's a reason why it's so important for us to read our Bibles daily. I want you to go to John 1:14, please. John 1:14. A lot of people don't realize how important and what the Word of God is. They just say, a man wrote it. Well, there's more than that, okay? So I want you to think about this. And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. And we beheld His glory in the glory of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Jesus is the Word. Christ is the Word. We make our real life with Him by studying. Now, I've had people say that Jesus spoke to me. That is not true. In fact, when you start speaking to them, you can see real quickly they've never picked up their Bible. Okay? Or they haven't studied their Bible. The only way today that Jesus speaks to us is through His Word. Okay? We have that, but Hebrews 1 tells us that's how He speaks to us. So we find everything we need by studying. Okay? Now, I want you now to go to 2 Peter 2:20 and 21. 2 Peter chapter 2, 20 and 21. I don't want you to be on this road, okay? So, it's going to be easy a little bit on you this week to be more faithful, more pure, more reading your Bibles because there's so many of you around. But the problem is when you leave here. But let's read what happens here in 20. 2 Peter chapter 2, 20. For if after they had escaped the pollutions of the world through the knowledge of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and they are entangled therein and overcome, the latter end is worse than that in the beginning. I want you to think about this. You're a Christian tonight. If you are, I want you to think about it. Have you went back into the world and started doing what the world does? Or have you ever even really had the knowledge of God? If you did, it's very serious for you to get your life right with God. So 21 says, for if it had been better for them not to have known the way of righteousness than after they have known it and turned from the holy commandments delivered unto them. But it has happened unto them, according to the true proverb, the dog is turned to his own vomit again, and the sow was washed with his own water in the mire. So I want you to think about this. You think that was sick a while ago about the boy eating that chili. But we do it all the time if we're not careful. Now think about it. You just don't look at it like that. Please think about it. All right. Here's the problem with the whole deal. Let's go to 1 Corinthians 15. 1 Corinthians 15. And this is going to help you out a little bit. If you take this advice, it'll help you a lot. If you'll read with me 33 and 34, this is why most people are not on the pure track to the Lord and have a real life with Him. Be not deceived. Evil communications corrupt good manners. Awake to righteousness and sin not, for some have not the knowledge of God. I speak this to your shame. I want to tell you something. I want you this week to have all the knowledge you can. I want to give you all I can right now, just a little bit. But I want you to think about it. The people you hang around, how are they? Really? Are they the people that you need to be around? Because that's usually whatever you're around is who you really are. You can say, oh, no, that's not the case. It probably is the case, more than likely. You just don't see it. You can see all their problems, but they put them on you too. So think about it. The things you watch, the things you listen to, some of the music you hear. There's just so many things that corrupt our minds. And we're not, you think about how much you're putting of the Word of God in you. Because that's the only thing that can purify your mind is the Word of God. And you think about all the things that you put in your mind. You put in movies, you have internet, you have the music, you have all kinds, and then you have your friends talking about all these things that are bad usually. It's hard. But you need to find more friends, or different friends, I mean, good friends. Friends that are living a pure life. Because if not, there's a bad place waiting for you if you're not careful. Alright? Alright. Please turn to Colossians 3, and we're going to do it verse 1. Colossians 3, we'll start at verse 1. I don't know what your goals are in life. Everybody's at a different point. Some of you are waiting for your permit that you can drive. Some of you are waiting for your driver's license. Some of you are waiting to get out of school. And you look at these things that you're waiting on. Trust me, it's not worth wasting your time thinking about them. They'll come soon enough. You think about the worldly things if you're not careful, and you miss the mark. Let's watch this. Chapter 3, Colossians 3, 1. If you then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. Set your affection on things above, not on things on the earth. For you are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall you also appear with Him in glory. How about it? I want you to think about it. Is your daily mind set on God above? Getting to heaven? Think about it. Because most of the time, we're waiting on the end of the day. We look at our clocks and we're saying, man, I wish the day was over, or something. Or I'm waiting for Friday or Saturday. You're wasting your life if you're thinking like this. Think about every day as a spiritual day, a pure day, and how can I do better in my life? And how can I help someone else? Please turn to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. Put your mind on this, verse 14. We'll start there. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, 14. Now we exhort you, brethren, warn them that are unruly, comfort the feeble mind, support the weak, be patient toward all men. See that none render evil for evil unto any man, but ever follow that which is good, both among yourselves and to all men. Rejoice evermore, pray without ceasing. I want you to think about that. Do you pray? When you wake up in the morning, are you praying? Tonight when you leave, are you praying? Another thing is, I want you to think about, are you thinking about others? Do you think about how you can help someone else? That it might be weak and you're stronger, hopefully? If you're weak, we want you to get right tonight with God. Okay? We need you to be strong when you leave here this week, where you can help those that are sick. And what I mean by that is spiritual. And you could be spiritually sick. And I know there's some in here probably tonight that aren't right with God. And I want you to really consider how you're living your life. Think about all the people around you and see how you can help them spiritually and forgive people. It's hard to do because most of you are at the age, I can't stand that person. They've done something to me. They stole my boyfriend, girlfriend. They took my pen or my notebook. Something, you know. There's always something that something's happened that you can make a reason to hate somebody. Find a reason why you can care about them. Okay? Because you know what? You took Jesus' life. Did they take your life? No. But we took Jesus' life and He forgives us. Think about it, please, as we go. Alright, I like doing lots of verses, alright? It doesn't matter to me. Let's go to James chapter 1. We're going to start with verse 22 through 27, alright? So here we go. James 1, 22. Do you believe I'm nervous? I am nervous. Alright? So just bear with me. Here we go. But be you doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. Do y'all do that? Do you read the Bible and you decide, I'm ignoring it. This movie is whatever. I'm going to go ahead and watch it. Don't deceive yourselves, please. Do what God says. Flee from sin. Let's keep on. 23. For if any be a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like unto a man beholding his own natural face in a glass. For he beholdeth himself and goeth his way, and straightway forgetteth what manner of man he was. But whosoever looked into the perfect law of liberty and continue therein, he being not forgetful here, but a doer of the work, this man shall be blessed in his deeds. I want you to know something. People say you do not work to go to heaven. They are a liar. You do spiritual work. I'm not saying that you'll ever do physical anything. But God has said to us that we will spiritually help people. We'll help ourselves, and we're going to be judged by the spiritual works that we do. If not, it talks too much about works. People say it all the time. You can't work your way to heaven. No, you cannot do any. You can do everything in the world, but it does not get you to heaven. But you are expected to do the best you can to help others. And it takes spiritual work to do that. And I mean, it's hard sometimes to make the right decisions. It's hard to change our lives. And it takes work, does it not? So when someone says you don't do anything, they're the devil. Alright? That's plain and simple. I can tell how it is. I'm the one teaching. Alright. Now, 25. But whosoever looked into the perfect law of liberty and continue therein, he being not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work, this man shall be blessed in his deeds. I'm sorry to read it twice, but still. We will be. But 26. If any man among you seem to be religious and broweth not his tongue, but deceiveth his own heart, this man's religion is vain. Now, I want to talk to you about this. I didn't want you to raise your hand for a minute. I wasn't going to do this, but I'm going to. Do the people around you think you're religious? I want you to raise your hand if the people around you think you're religious. Okay, that's good. But now, I'm going to say something to you. This is going to be kind of mean. If they don't think you're religious, you're probably not religious. You know what I'm saying? So, get religious. Alright? The other thing is, 27, I like this part. Pure religion and undefiled before God and the Father is this, to visit the fatherless. These are people that do not have God. I want you to look at that. These are not people that just don't have a dad. These are people that don't have God. You're to visit those people. And widows in affliction and keep themselves unspotted from the world. If you're a Christian, you're to be unspotted. You're trying to be pure and help others. That's what Christians are all about. Now, I'm not done. But I want you to listen to what I'm going to say to you, please. This is important. I hear this a lot from people that are brothers and sisters in Christ. And they're mistaken. I don't care how you act. I don't care how good you are, and you're supposed to act as good as you can and as pure as you can. You're commanded, and I am too. But it doesn't matter how pure I live my life. No one ever becomes a Christian just by your example. I want to say that to you. If that was true, then God wasted His time telling us to go preach the Word of God to people. He should have said, go act good and right and don't do nothing else. No, He says, go act good and right and go talk to people about Me, because the ultimate teacher was Jesus Himself. And even He had to go preach to the people. So it don't matter how you act, it does matter how you act. I've got to rephrase that. I don't care how good you think you are. Without you talking to someone about God, it is not doing them any good or you any good. So I want you to understand that very well. Do not think you go through life without taking, open your mouth, because it takes preachers. And you girls have to teach too, okay? I'm not saying you'll get in front of the auditorium and assembly. I'm talking about you have friends that you talk with. You know your girl night outs, whatever, pajama parties, that's what they call it, whatever. You can talk about it, all right? So, now, I like it backing everything up with the Bible. So, let's go to Matthew 28, if you think I'm wrong with what I just said. I've had people tell me that I was wrong. But the problem is, they're saying God is wrong. Because Matthew 28, 19, 20 tell us exactly what we should do. Christ says, are you ready for this? Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I commanded you. Lo, I'm with you always, even unto the end of the world. Amen. Now think about this. He says, I'm teaching you disciples to go out and talk to people, baptize people. And I'm telling you to tell them to go do the same thing. Is that right? Is that what we're supposed to do? Because that's what God says. We're commanded to, right? Now you can ignore like everybody else and do whatever you want to, or you can be on the track of a pure life and real life with Jesus and do it. I'll tell you how important it is. I want you to Acts 18:6, please. 18:6. Acts 18:6, boy. Here we go. Paul's here, okay? And when they opposed themselves and blasphemed, Paul shook his raiment and said unto them, your blood be upon your own heads. I am clean. From henceforth I will go to the Gentiles. See, Paul knew it was very important to go teach souls. He was worried about, now he didn't want to tell everybody about Jesus Christ because that was his life. He had a real life with Christ. And I want you to think about it. Everybody you come in contact with, if you're a Christian, you're responsible to maybe to talk to them about God. Did you know that? How would you feel? This is the deal. I know we all imagine how heaven and hell is going to be in this gate before you go in there. But let's think about this. Let's just go to the scenario. It is a place that the good people over here and the bad people over there. All right? You're supposed to be a Christian. You're supposed to be real good friends with everybody. But the problem is, you're scared to talk to them because they're not going to be your friend anymore, more likely. And you're not going to let God work it out for you. You're going to say, I'm not going to talk to them about God. And then someday, somehow, you did get in that line that goes to heaven. But your friend's going, why didn't you tell me? Why? You ain't much of a friend. All right? Jesus is your friend, and He's a friend to everybody that serves Him, all right? Now, I want you to think about it. Are you really a true friend, not talking to someone about God? Are you more worried about your friendship than their soul? You're looking on things on earth. Now, this is the good part, okay? There's five things I'm going to do before I quit, okay? These are things you've heard your whole life, probably, if you've been going to church. But I'm going to go over them really quickly here. And I want you to write them down. I'm going to give you the five things. I started backwards kind of than that. I told you what you should have been doing if you're a Christian. But if you're not a Christian, or you're just not sure of it, I'm going to help you with that right now. But I'm going to use the Bible to do that for you. Okay? So the first thing we're going to do is, there's no one can find out about God except someone go tell them about the Word of God. So we're going to use Romans 10:17, that our faith comes from the Word of God. It says, faith comes from hearing, hearing by the Word of God. Please turn there, please. Romans 10:17. Faith comes from hearing, hearing by the Word of God. You know, everybody's got a faith. If you look at our world, there's all kinds of different beliefs out there. But the problem is, they're not all going by the Bible, which most of them are not. They use a little bit of the Bible. They have a concept, but they don't go by it. But if you want the one faith and the one God that I know about in Ephesians 4:5, He says to get into the book and search it. This is a good one. I want to ask you a question. Don't answer it, please. I've had lots of adults that can't answer this question. It's a word that's used all the time. It's the word believe. Tell me, I want you to think about it. Don't say it out loud. But right now, in your mind, I'm asking you what the word believe means. What would be your definition if I asked you the word believe? Now think about it. It's used, John 3:16 is used all the time. I mean, you name it, people say, I believe. I'm going to give you the Bible definition, but first let's go to Mark 16:16, and I'm going to help you a little bit. All right? I'm going to read it, give you definition, and I'm going to read it again with the definition. All right? Here we go. Jesus says, All right. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned. If you look at there, there's the same word, identical. The word is identical spelled. You would think it's meant the same thing, but it really doesn't. The first one is trust. The second one is obey. The American Standard does it very well, but I'm a King James fan, so I'll stick with it. But I want to read it now with the definition in it and see if it makes more deeper thinking, I guess you'd say. Here we go. He that trusts and is baptized shall be saved, but he that obeyeth not shall be damned. That's the word. That's the definition. Your definition of belief is trust and obey. Alright? Now don't forget that, because it's something that you need to always remember. Okay? Because people don't have that definition, most of them. And I'm sure some of you did not know that definition, surely. Next thing. Repent. Alright? I'm going to use our favorite thing, Acts 2:38. Repent means to turn away from sin. But I'm going to read it. Let's go to Acts 2:38. Y'all, repenting is, believing will be something you always do. Hearing will be something you always do. And repenting will be something you do the rest of your life. I don't know, are you a Christian? Think about it. Have you been trying to live a better life, a pure life? If you're not, if you want to, I sure want you to think about it, to do that this week, or tonight even. But here we go, Acts 2:38. Remember, they crucified Jesus, and the Jews asked, or the Israelites asked, Peter, how can I be saved? And he says to them, then Peter said to them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Repent is one of those things you do before you're baptized or before you're saved. Next one. This is something that really gets a lot of people in the Lord's church here. Another one. Confess. If you ask the world what you do, confess, they'll say, I confess my sins. Or I confess this or that. I want you to turn to Romans chapter 10, 9 and 10. Romans 10, 9 and 10. This is important, please. I'm telling you to think about this. I'm going to give you the definition of this word confess and see if it makes sense. But first, I'm going to read it. And then I'm going to put the definition in it. Okay? Here we go. Romans 10, 9 and 10. That if thou shalt confess with the mouth of the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God had raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. Alright. You know that word confess means? It means marriage. It means a vow. A promise. So when I decide that I'm going to be a Christian, I will say, Jesus, I want to be in your life. I want to be your life. I want to be one with you. See, that's what you do when you get married. When you become a husband and wife, you say, I do. I want to be with you the rest of my life. Good or bad, I want to be with you. That's the same word here. I want to make a promise, Jesus. I want to be with you the rest of my life. Now, some people say you're already saved. Well, that's all you got to do. That's not true. If you look at verse 10, it says, unto. Well, it doesn't say you have to be baptized there. Well, I'm going to talk about baptism, but if you look at verse 16. See, a lot of people don't do this, and they don't understand. This book was already written to Christians in the first place. But it says, but they have not obeyed the gospel. Now I'm asking you, have you obeyed the gospel? It's the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Last thing. And it's baptism. And I want you to go to Romans chapter 6. Alright? And I want to explain something to you. Water does not save you. Okay? I want you to understand that. Water does not save you. But obeying what God says is what saves you. Okay? Not what you think. It's what you know and God tells you. So here we go. We're going to Romans 6, 3 through 7. And think about the crucifixion of Jesus Christ. That He was crucified, that He died, and He was buried, and He arose. I want you to think, have you done that? So here we go. Know ye not that Smiths were baptized into Jesus Christ, were baptized into His death. Therefore we are buried with Him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. For if we have been planted together in the likeness of His death, we shall also be in the likeness of His resurrection. Knowing this, that our old man is crucified with Him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin. For he that is dead is free from sin. This is the only way that you can get in Christ, being buried in Him. This only way you can die with Christ is being buried with Him. And this only way you can be raised up out of that water is to understand that it is the gospel. It is the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Now, I told you five things. I told you about hearing, believe, repent, confess, and be baptized. I want to ask you a question. Which one of those five can I take out and you be saved? Do what? Very good. Because your worldly friends and people around you do not believe that. It takes all five of them. It takes the obedience of every one of them to be saved. Now I'm asking you tonight, I know some of you are young, but you that are thinking about being in Christ and are mature enough that you know how to live your life and you can go teach someone the Word of God. I want you to consider your life tonight. Are you on the pure direction and have a real life with Christ? I want you to think about that. Do you? You know, I probably pushed some buttons on some adults tonight too. Alright? And I hope I did. Because if we're not doing it, our kids ain't doing it. Alright? So, tonight, I'm asking you right now, if you're not right with God right now, I want you to come up forward right now. Let's take care of that, because you don't know when in the world's coming. But, if you're thinking about this week, talk to your counselors, talk to someone. I'll be round off and on. You can grab me up, whatever. I don't care. Or Alan or whoever. Think about it. That's why we're here this week, to understand. So, you will? Where's my song leader at? Right in front of me. Let's sing.
I am a Jesus is my Lord. He